Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate our Savior this week. Lord Jesus, who are the living bread that came down from heaven, Lord, have
mercy.
Lord Jesus, you were sent by the Father to bring life to the people. Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the way to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you. This is the bread that comes down from heaven
so that one may live and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
There is a Latin word in our tradition, viaticum. Literally, it means for the journey, with the connotation of what is needed for a journey. In other words, the provisions. Provisions for a journey. It has its roots in ancient Greek culture, where a huge meal was fed to someone who was about to embark on a long journey, of course, most of which would have been on foot. The idea was that the person could then skip a meal or two, which would enable them to travel a long ways and not have to worry about food for a while. The item is part of the last rites. The definition of last rites is the final sacramental rites done on a person while still alive. Simply put, viaticum is Holy Communion, given for the last time and using a special rite that we use just for that. In that rite, it refers to viaticum as food for the journey. If you have a loved one who is dying, and if you call the priest while the person still has the ability to eat or drink a little and the ability to participate in the rite, that person should be given Holy Communion under the form of viaticum. Now, I realize this is not always possible, especially in something like a car wreck. In that case, anointing of the sick becomes the last rites. But our tradition prefers that a person receive communion along with that. It becomes food for the journey over the waters of death. We human beings have an insatiable desire for life, which is why our first reading is so striking. Here is Elijah, possibly the greatest Hebrew prophet ever, and he's had enough of life. He's lost all hope. He wishes he were dead because he thinks that his prophetic career has been an abysmal failure. He is the last of God's faithful prophets. The whole people are turning away from God to worship false gods. Queen Jezebel wants Elijah dead. So to him, his life has no more point, no more purpose. He has failed, and he wants God to end his life. So God sends an angel to speak words of reassurance. He restores Elijah's strength by means of the bread and water that he provides that enable him to make the journey to Mount Horeb, also known as Mount Sinai, the symbol of hope, of God's very presence. Life is sometimes likened to a journey, or perhaps even a pilgrimage, which is a sacred journey. We need to be fed on our journeys, just as Elijah was fed in the first reading today. And Jesus offers us that food in today's gospel. Today is the third installment of John chapter 6. Here, the aspect of the Eucharist that is being treated is the fact that we receive the spiritual nourishment that we need from God to do what we need to do spiritually in this life. Through feeding on Jesus' body at Mass every week, and even more often if possible, at daily Mass. Jesus talks about this helping in two ways. First, it gives spiritual life to us, and through us, to the world. Second, as the bread which enables us to live forever, Jesus' metaphorical way of talking about the afterlife, a and what happens after we die as a result of receiving Him. I would hope that you have noticed that your reception of Holy Communion on a regular basis has enabled you to live life better as a Christian, and that there are things that you could not have done spiritually in this life had it not been for the Eucharist. Now, maybe if you're a young person, you haven't quite experienced that yet. But, you know, if you're my age, and you can't say that, as was said on Apollo 13, Houston, we have a problem here. I have to say that I have noticed this in my own life. I have noticed how much I need Christ to nourish me. I'm one of the branches. He is the vine. I can do nothing without Him. He is my source. Being cut off of my source would mean death. Just as cutting the branch off the vine would mean death for the branch. And furthermore, whatever fruit I'm producing is because that's what branches do when they are connected to the vine, which nourishes them to produce that very fruit. When I was a sophomore in college, in mid-December of 1986, a friend and I climbed, well, we thought it would be a bright idea to climb Harney Peak, now called Blackout Peak, the highest peak in the Black Hills and the highest point in the lower 48 east of the Rocky Mountains. This was my first real hiking journey, where I carried my own food and tent and sleeping bag and so forth. I was not very smart about such things back then. So my pack, which weighed about 80 pounds, had a lot in it that was unnecessary, including a 12-pack of Pepsi. The week before this brought much snow and then thawing weather, so we slipped many times and fell down on the icy trail heading up the mountain. When we finally got near the top, we pitched our tent as the sun slipped behind the mountain. We were totally exhausted. We tried to start a fire to cook a meal, and then discovered that the big hams in our backpacks were frozen solid, because by then it was minus 10 degrees. And a blizzard had hit an hour before we got to the top. Now in those days, I didn't eat breakfast, and my lunchtime didn't happen because I was packing for this trip. So now I was also not going to get a supper. Jeff looked at me and said, "I'm afraid if we try to sleep here tonight, we might freeze to death." I mean, at that point, I was wearing jeans, mistake number 85, cotton next to your sweaty skin, which now, because it was so cold, was frozen onto my legs. My legs literally were just sitting there. Now, Jeff had more winter camping experience than I did. Zero at that point. So I agreed that we should pack up and leave during a blizzard at night. Again, we slipped many times on the way down. Both of us had gone well beyond our normal physical abilities. So Jeff said, "Hey, let's each of us guzzle a couple of Pepsis to get some energy." Thankfully, they had not fully frozen because they were in my pack, being warmed by my massive body from carrying such a heavy pack on an icy trail. But it had started to begin to freeze, but just not enough, so it was totally frozen. So we got a couple of them down. And we were able to go another mile before we had to do the very same thing. We got lost in the dark twice and used a cigarette lighter to illuminate a sign we had found, which pointed us in the right direction. The trail had been drifted over by the blowing snow of the blizzard. Our flashlight batteries were dead. We didn't even bother to check before we left. The wind got worse and started some of the tall pine trees around us creaking, so we wondered if they might come down on us. By the time we got back to the car, all 12 Pepsis had been down. And we give thanks to God that we were alive. You know, it's quite possible that had it not been for the Pepsi, one or both of us would have laid down from complete exhaustion, saying, just a little rest, please, and maybe pass out or went to sleep. And we would have died. Because we found out later that it got down to minus 40 with the wind chill that night on Harmony Peak. You know, I've thought a lot about this sometimes as I have received communion. It's food for the journey that keeps, that gives me what I need to keep going, like that Pepsi did. I think it has probably saved my life by keeping me off the path that I have been traveling as a young man at that point in my life. Ultimately, all of us are going to take the journey across the waters of death. Jesus said today, whoever eats this bread will live forever. So we ask Jesus today, please, give us this food always. Help us to see how much we need you. Help us to hunger and thirst for you until the day that we take our last breath.
Let us stand now together and confess.
Church, that we may ever be a source of nourishment to the hungry, hope to the discouraged, and faith to those in despair. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in offices of power, that they may never lose sight of the powerless and their needs. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
offer you today. Find your pleasing to you and grant them, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread of poverty. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed
are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Our salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
kingdom were scattered apart by sin. Through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gathered them again to yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity, made the body of Christ in the temple of the Holy Spirit, might, to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as the Church. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Thank you.
the Savior's command and informed by my teaching, we dare to say.
Thank you. happens to be the anniversary of the Philip Sunday. And so I thought, what a good day for an all-day hearing. So I went to bed in a little theater. I mean, a little chapel. On October 13th, we'll have a whole day retreat and then go out at noon to do the public rosary rally around the various missions. So I'm looking for any volunteers who would be interested in helping with that. If you have any ideas, maybe music, or some such, and we'd like to lend your talents to that. Please call me, I'll be over. Thank you.
This Wednesday is a holy day of obligation, the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary. We will have Mass Tuesday evening, the day before, at 5:30 p.m. for that observance. See Carol and Kevin for tickets for the Ambrose Grandchildren fundraiser, or you may purchase tickets at the door also, $25 per person, for Saturday, August 18th, 5 to 9 p.m. And please join us for the barbecue right after this Mass, right outside the church. Let us pray. In the communion in your sacrament that we have consumed, save us, O Lord, and confirm us in the light of your truth, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
May
Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go forth.